Paul, your article, The Chemical Weapon Taboo, is just great analysis of what it is that causes us to somehow not think quite as rationally about a chemical weapon attack as we do a conventional attack, even though a conventional attack has the propensity to kill just as many people, if not more. What's your take on this whole taboo of chemical weapons?
Well, I'm not completely sure where it comes from. You know, there are people who have suggested it's about our kind of evolutionary fear of being poisoned, and that's where we put it in this kind of separate category. But the taboo has existed for a long time, even though we now, only in the last few decades, have an actual international convention against the use of chemical weapons. It was really after World War I that people started to talk about them as being something that was particularly heinous and somehow worse than other kinds of conventional weapons that people get killed by being blown up or shot. We then codified that in this international convention, and then we have situations like this one where, 100,000 people were killed in Syria, and they were killed by bullets and bombs, and we were certainly expressing our consternation and being upset about it, but we weren't going to commit any kind of resources or get the United States involved in a military action. But once you had those 1,400 people who were killed by chemical weapons, now we've said that that's just something that we cannot tolerate, tolerate the other kind.
Yeah, the moral imperative changes, as you put it, this collective horror that we have about chemical weapons, all of a sudden becomes to the front of our concerns, even though we knew, as you pointed out, Assad's already murdered 100,000 people of all type. Every kind of awful thing that can be done to a human body, he's done. So now is this, but is this what's really driving this war? I mean, isn't this more of a chant for war? Let me not call it a war, but it is a chant for war. And we have now a president who's drawn a line in the sand, I guess, has the same reaction, this, I guess, to some degree, about the taboo of chemical weapons. But really, isn't this more about him saying, if you use chemical weapons, here's the line in the sand, we'll do something about it? Didn't he box us in with that?
Well, that, I think there's a lot of truth to that, that once he said there's this red line, and if you do that, then we're going to get involved. Once he committed himself to that, he may have made the decision that he cannot go back on that commitment. So now he has to initiate some kind of a military action.
Interesting thing, Paul. This week he's stepping back from that. I don't know if you've noticed that. So he's all but said, I really never made a red line threat, but I've gone back and he clearly made a red line threat, and this does box him in. Okay, but add to that, it's easy to box somebody in when we think of the horror of chemical weapons. I mean, that is what scares. I mean, that's easy to go to the public and say, look, yeah, we know down in Rwanda that they're cutting off people's arms and they're deballing pregnant women. But what about this? Look at these horrible pictures. These people were killed with chemicals. Is that real in this situation? I mean, is that really what's driving all this?
Well, you know, I think that there are always a lot of different influences that come into play. I mean, I think you're right on what you said before, that once he made the statement, he felt like he was kind of boxed into it and had to follow up on it. You know, we spend a lot of time talking about things like credibility and that don't really have any kind of real value. It's more symbolic value. But if you listen to the arguments that the administration is making now, it's mostly about stuff that could happen in the future if we don't do this. You know, he might have more attacks, or it might embolden Iran. You know, whenever we have a situation like this, you always hear the word embolden. Someone's always going to get emboldened. And yeah, in this case, it's Iran that's going to get emboldened.
Well, we also hear Kerry on this one. Kerry's saying, not only are we going to embolden Iran, we're also going to embolden the terrorists to now go to Syria, steal the chemical weapons, and come back and use them on our children. I mean, aren't you hearing that as well? Again, chemical weapons scares the hell out of us, and now the terrorists are going to go get them. they're going to bring them back here and use them against us, much like we remember in the Iraq. Remember, they had anthrax and they had smallpox that they were going to put in our water. The horror was just palpable.
Right, so, and I think they know that that people have a kind of a visceral reaction against that, even though in practical terms, you know, chemical weapons are not very useful if you're a terrorist. It's a lot easier to build a bomb that can blow something up than it is to kill large numbers of people with chemical weapons. And that's why it's almost never happened. The only real case in recent times has been the Aum Shinrikyo cult in Japan, which killed about a dozen people in that subway. Because chemical weapons are, you know, they're difficult to deal with. They are hard to, you know, they disperse quickly. And so it's actually more practical. If your goal is to kill people, it's easier to do it with bullets and bombs. Now, why the Assad regime decided to use them, you know, it may be that they were counting on the ability of chemical weapons to ignite that kind of horror among the Syrian population. That maybe it was a way for him to show his opponents that he'll resort to anything, and that therefore, you know, to instill more fear and make it harder for the rebels to gain support among the public. Who knows? But the idea that terrorists are going to use chemical weapons instead of, you know, the relatively simple bomb making that they can't seem to do very successfully. I don't think that there's a lot of a real practical relevance to that as a threat that we should really be afraid of.
Yeah, I think this as you're looking at this and you have it in your you've put it in your article, The Chemical Weapons Taboo. Again, well done. I've heard this being knocked around since this article came out, and that is, you know, are we in a place to where the chemical weapon taboo, this red line, let's call it the red line issue, you've crossed the red line. Now, it's as if it automatically gives us the right to use this huge military force, which is probably the strongest thing we have in the U.S. right now. We've, you know, manufacturing's gone. You know, we employment is in the can. We have all kinds of infrastructure problems. Can't decide what the hell's going on with healthcare. But we know we're a strong military might. And you had I think it was in this last article that you wrote. You talk about Madeleine Albright, you know, who was Bill Clinton's Secretary of State. That she said one time to Clinton Powell, Colin Powell, that what's the point of having this superb military if all you're going to do is talk about it and can't use it? Do you ever get that sense that's out there and maybe we're seeing it now? Talk about that, if you would.
Well, I guess to an extent. I mean, one of the things, if you look back over recent history, almost every president, whether they're Democrat or Republican, eventually decides there's someplace they want to bomb or invade. And, you know, I think that oftentimes Democrats feel like when they get elected, then that's not going to happen. But it happens with Democratic presidents, too. I mean, Obama used our military in Libya. We're now probably going to use it in Syria. Bill Clinton launched a relatively small to mid-sized invasion of Haiti. He had bombing campaigns in Serbia and Kosovo. I mean, you can look at each one of those things in isolation and say, yes, that was justified, there were good reasons for it, or maybe not. But the truth is that military always ends up getting used. The only president in recent decades who didn't use the military to go and engage in some foreign land was Jimmy Carter. But all the other ones did, whether they were Democrats or Republicans.
Have it there. It's almost tempting. So it's tempting to use. It's almost you almost can't resist the idea. Gee whiz, we have some new drones. We have
right.
we fashioned some new drones. We have some new missiles, some new smart missiles. We have new things, new radars. We have new toys that McDonnell Douglas and Boeing has presented us. We paid a lot of money for them. They're sitting on the shelf. Let's go use them while we can. In the last 20 years, you get that sense more and more.